I know that all of us come from a shared context of eternal busyness, preoccupation, distraction, overstimulation. There's a lot of stuff that's going on inside of us. Let's take a conscious moment to be here. We'll be spending approximately 1800 minutes together. 18 minutes, around 100 people. And these will be irreversible minutes. So better make it worth it. And to make it worth it, I would need just one thing from you, and that is your complete presence. I want you to be here with me. So for a moment, switch off all those ancient tabs that are open on the browser of your mind. All those tabs that have been open from times immemorial that you think you would come back and check one day. Close them and come here. There's a Harvard research study that says 47% of the times we are thinking of something other than we are doing in the moment. Please help me disprove this study today. Be here with me and connect. The biology of interruption, the biology of disconnection is breathlessness. When we are interrupted, when you are checking your WhatsApp messenger, your breath goes off. It's like anticipation mode. The biology of connection is deep rhythmic breath. So from time to time, I will be bringing your attention to your own breath. And that would be like our common ritual to ensure synchronicity. So are you here? Can you take a deep breath again with me? Nice deep breath. When you take a healthy breath, then your tummy expands, and when you release it, then your tummy comes back to your normal size. A lot of times we are unconsciously doing it the opposite way, and it may be causing us discomfort, but we ignore it or we overlook it. When we ignore unease for a long time, it becomes dis-ease. So it's absolutely important to come back to ourselves and to connect with our own selves. Yeah? Interestingly, if your visiting card says that you're a happiness coach, then the professional hazard of that is that you're most likely to be asked three questions very frequently. Number one, how to be happy? Number two, how old are you? And number three, when will you marry? In the course of this conversation, we would skip the last two questions and we would focus on one insight that has significantly improved the quality of relationships, both within myself and without myself. So I asked myself as I was preparing for this talk that what is that one thing that I learned which seems to be the most qualitative insight for my life so far? And I want to share that with you. I would speak to you with an open heart. I hope you listen to me with an open mind. So as a child, I had this personal myth. And I believed in this personal story with some degree of conviction. I used to believe that the two adults in my household, named my mother and father, were not my real parents. I used to believe that these people have abducted my biological parents and hidden them somewhere. So the man who claimed to be my father used to go to work at 9 in the morning and come back at 9:30 p.m. During most part of my childhood, he did not take any weekly leave. And the woman who came to be my mother was also perpetually busy to create a perfect, prim and proper household. And whenever I went up to them to talk to them, either they were already in the middle of something or the television serial that they were watching was in the middle of something. So I really missed them. Interestingly, the only time it seems that they temporarily released my real parents was the time when I was unwell. So when I was unwell, I got all the love and care and attention. So the result of that was, growing up, while other children craved for pushback cars, skipping ropes, games, computer, whatnot, I was fantasizing about getting unwell so that I may get some more attention. And with an immunity that is as strong as mine, I could get fever only once in a year. So I had to depend on peer wisdom to get unwell. And the peer wisdom says that take some onion, take some garlic, put it under your arm, reach the required bodily temperature that you would qualify you for that extra attention. That did not work too. Interestingly, few years down the line, my parents had the same question, the same complaint from me. The complaint was, why are you always busy? Why are you not present? Very interesting. I grew up deeply disliking this eternal, perpetual busyness and always keep yourself busy syndrome. But at the age of 18, I was doing 3 courses, full-time course in English, 2 part-time courses in psychology and German, along with a part-time course, part-time job as a telephonic counselor. So what I disliked the most, I had absorbed from my environment. Very interesting. We might absorb what we think we dislike and we never want in our life. Very interesting question. If you inquire yourself that some of the things that we might have absorbed unconsciously through osmosis. Self-inquiry, very important. I did not want my parents to think that I had abducted their real daughter. So I thought of thinking about this question of presence and absence. I asked myself this question, that what happens if an individual makes the decision to be with someone completely? What happens if I go to someone with only one intention, to be with this person completely, without any other thought on my mind? If I'm here in this time space, if I get rid of that cloak of multitasking, of all the things that are there in my mind, and be here, what would that do to the quality of my relationships? How is your breath? Take a deep breath in. This is the question I thought of asking myself again and again. I slowed the pace of my life and I thought of offering my complete presence to the ones I loved. And I tried to do this also in my professional space with organizations, at my own enterprise at Perfect Life Spot, to create spaces where whenever you go, there will be someone who would listen to you with only one intention, and that intention would not to reply, but to listen to you. When they look at you, the intention would not be to look for something, but to look at you. What happens? The person who you offer your complete presence suddenly, for the first time, feels connected. And an entire world of perception opens. When you look into their eyes, you can see that very thin film of moisture. You can see the depth of their eyes. You can hear, without them having to verbalize it, the journeys that they have had so far. You might even sense that they are dehydrated. You might even listen to their unmet needs, needs that they have not realized yet. If you offer your complete presence to someone, you become a present. Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh, he says, the most precious gift that you can offer someone is the gift of your true presence. Imagine that. Today, going back, thinking about one person that you really love, sitting with that person with only this one intention, that I will spend these 5 minutes completely offering my true presence to this person. Now certain things happen. Automatically your biology would resist this. You would see that your leg starts moving. You might also see that something like this happens. These are the thoughts that would take you away from this person. And these thoughts will appear urgent and important. Specifically, all those notifications that are waiting to be checked, specifically that particular message box wherein you have revealed all your life in 600 characters and the other person is still typing the message, and on that person a lot of things depend. And you would have this idea of feeling distracted and going back and listening to other conversations that are going on. And that is where it becomes even more important to train our mind to come here back to ourselves, to create space inside of us, to offer ourselves completely. The paradox is that you cannot offer yourself completely unless you have yourself. Unless you are not here for your own self, you cannot offer yourself completely. So we say that self-love is a mandatory requirement for true love. That means that intrapersonal relationship is extremely important for any interpersonal relationship. So, in order to be able to offer or develop the capacity of offering your complete presence to someone else, your body must feel comfortable. Your minds must feel comfortable. And if they are not feeling comfortable, then don't judge yourself. Ask yourself, how can I make myself feel comfortable? And the inner child inside of us understands only one language, and that language is of gentleness. You cannot be harsh on yourself. Otherwise, it withdraws and closes down and would not talk to you, would not share with you. So gently you ask yourself that, am I in a position to offer my complete presence to someone who is right here in front of me? And if you are, then offer. If you are not, then take solitude, invest on yourself, become comfortable and come back. Companionship after a healthy spell of solitude is an extremely beautiful gift. A lot of times we enter into relationships to compensate for self-love deficit, which is how toxic relationships are formed. Not just with people, but with devices, but with food, but with sleep. We are more likely to overeat or undersleep or oversleep and so on and so forth if we do not have a comfortable relationship with our own self. How is your breath? Are we connected? Is your breath rhythmic? Yeah. A research study proves that people who are in love, they start imitating each other's breathing rhythms and heartbeats. Interesting. How our biology, our physiology, mimics our psychology. Mind and body are related. Individual and society are related. All existence is coexistence. We do not live in isolation. And hence, it is extremely important to see if we are present while we are here. Take a moment, close your eyes and feel your breath. Can we do this little practical exercise? So you are sitting straight and close your eyes. 5-second exercise. Just notice your body. And as you have closed your eyes, just look at the darkness of your closed eyes. Very interesting darkness. This darkness has variety. And do also experience your breath alongside. A nice deep breath, inhale and exhale. Once more, inhale, exhale. Slowly open your eyes. Wonderful, excellent. It is a huge achievement for a huge group like ours to be comfortable in silence. So you have done that. That's amazing. Today, if you go back home and ask yourself, how is my relationship with myself? How is my relationship with the devices I use? How is my relationship with the environment that I live in? Do the people I love feel loved? Am I doing so much that I don't get time to be with them? Our doing must emerge from our being. If our doing becomes an escape from our being, then it is not fulfilling. These are the things that I want you to think about. I deeply believe that each one of us have the capacity to heal all of us from the mental states that lead to suffering. And it all begins with a decision, with a choice, with an intention. Slowly, like a child, you open yourself to new possibilities. Think about that. Very interesting. think about the fact that how silence becomes more meaningful when it comes out of true presence. Also, words become more impactful when they are being felt from within. If today, after the 18 minutes that we spent together, you can go back and just think about this one thought, that am I present and how is my breath? The entire 20 hours that it took me to cover the journey to come here would be worth it. Yeah. Is that a possibility? Yeah. I know you're being recorded, so you're being shy. That's okay, I understand. But think about that. Think about the possibilities that might be there once you decide to offer your true presence. You might open up an entire space of perceptions that you might not have realized. And you would hear stories from your loved ones that you had never heard before. And in that sharing, you become alchemists, alchemists of love. Because in those sharings, suddenly there comes a moment when you become at one with each other. And in that moment of at-one-ment, when you forget that you are a separate reality, that's called love. Love is that kind of a liberation when you overlap with someone with such congruence that you forget that you are different. It's transcendence from your ego. It's an experience of transcendence, expansion, and hence liberation. I would close with a beautiful anecdote given by Thich Nhat Hanh. He said that if you put a handful of salt in a glass of water, it becomes undrinkable. But if you put the same handful of salt in a river, it can be still used for various purposes. So grow, expand, become present to yourself. Ask yourself this question, that do I have the capacity to take care of my needs, to look, listen, sense my own needs, and then go out and offer yourself completely with your mind and body, with a rhythmic breath, to whoever you love. If we can do that, then everything would work for us. We are all we need. The solution isn't in going out, it's in coming back, reconnecting with our own selves, and then you might realize that you are the miracle that you were looking for. Thank you.